Ya ayyuhan nabi, prophet. Now the Prophet ﷺ is given more instruction. Qulli azwajik, tell your wives. Wabanatik, and this time also tell your daughters. Wanisa'il muslimin, and also include the women of all believers. Allah could have just said, tell the women of the believers, and that includes everybody. But Allah says, start with your family. And in this surah, everything has been directed at the family of the Prophet ﷺ, but now we're learning what we're supposed to have learned all along. In the labib min al-isharati yafham, that it's supposed to not just be for your spouses, it's also for your daughters. And these rules also apply now to the mothers, the believing women, all believing women, women of all believing families. يُدْنِينَ عَلَيْهِنَّ مِنْ جَلَابِيبِهِنَّ. Let's take these words bit by bit, because this is a sensitive ayah, and a cause for entire seminars in secular circles about reinterpreting Islam under progressive thought. Right, to take some of these ayat and just kind of revisit them entirely, and let's figure out some way of interpreting them that meets our own personal whims. Ma'na al-idna, yudnina, the Arabic word yudnina, idna taqribu shay'i min shay', to bring something close to something. And so Allah says, qutufuha daniya, in Jannah, the branches of the trees, those massive trees in Jannah, their branches, they come close to you, so they're called daniya, they lower themselves. They lower themselves. So adna means two things, to bring close and to lower. Wa ay qariba at-tanawul sahlat al-jani. Yani in that particular ayah, it means it's so close that you can just take it and it's easy to pick off. Wal muradu yudnina jalabibihinna ay min al-ard litastar al-jism. First, let's again, adna, to draw something over, to drop something down, to bring something down. It's the image of somebody putting on a garment, and when they put it on, it drops. You know how you put a shirt on and it drops on your body? It drops. This is adna, it's dropping. Now somebody puts on a long dress, they put it over themselves, and as they put it on, it drops, it drapes over. This is from the word idna. So whatever Allah is talking about, whatever kind of garment Allah is talking about, number one isn't tight. Why can't it be tight? Because if it's tight, it doesn't drop. It doesn't drop on its own. Two, It's loose in the sense that it's not one piece, or it's not multiple pieces, it's one piece that falls. It just falls over. Now, yudnina, let's talk about alayhinna. They should drop whatever this garment is over themselves. So the garment is coming from above. One part of it has to be above. Alay, now it gets to the head. Now, the head covering specifically has already been mentioned where? Surah An-Nur. The head covering has already been mentioned. What's supposed to be covered? And there what was highlighted is the hair shouldn't show. That was the first thing. And the second thing was that the chest should be covered in a loose way, so it's drawn over. So whatever a woman's wearing, her hijab falls over her chest, and it's, the jayb was mentioned there. Okay? Now, yudnina alayhinna, they should veil over themselves, draw over themselves, min jalabibihinna, jalbab, yani a large cloth. Khimar is a larger cloth too. Khimar is up to, you could say if you were putting a khimar on, it would cover almost up to your belly. That would be a khimar. If you were putting on the jalbab, it would cover from head to toe. That large garment would be head to toe. And that's kind of in different cultures in the Islamic world, this manifested in different ways, right? So there's the hijab piece, and there's the jilbab piece. Then there is the rocket ship thing, right? You just, some cultures have like the whole thing in one drop, and there's this thing for the eyes, right? That's their variation of jilbab. There's a lot of commentary about this ayah and what it means, okay? So you'll find a huge variation even among the Sahaba on how to interpret this ayah. What does it mean to wear a jilbab? And you guys know jilbabs now because they're selling in every Islamic store and, online and jilbab fashions, etc., etc. If your jilbab is tight and it takes you a while to put it down, it's not a jilbab. That's one thing that's already clear now. So it has to be loose. The second thing is it covers, it's the entire body. It's dropping over, it's draping over the entire body. Now, how did that, again, I can't have a fiqh conversation with you, that's for fuqaha or people that study fiqh in depth. But I can share with you some opinions of the Sahaba. Like for example, some Sahaba that used to be from the people of the book, Abdullah bin Salam for example. You know what his opinion was about jilbab? One eye should show. The entire body should be covered, not hands, not anything, and one eye should show. And barely. So she could kind of like, submarine style, kind of see through what's going on. Now, why did he have that opinion? Because actually he was a rabbi before. And the particular school of rabbinic tradition that he belonged to, a woman's pinky showing was equal to zina. So he had the most conservative interpretation of this ayah. This is what yudnina alayhinna min jalabi bihinna means. Other sahaba had different stances. Other sahaba said, no, we have to understand this in light of, first of all, the ayah of Surah An-Nur that is coming later, but we have to combine both of them. And actually, it's cool to know that this came first and that came later. So in the beginning, it was that you kind of have this garment, like a lot of our sisters wear the jilbab, and it's supposed to cover the head and fall over it. Like it's kind of like, you know, you've seen a hood? Have you ever seen Assassin's Creed posters? It's kind of like, it's just kind of draping over. So it's making the face a little bit of a mystery. Okay? Or it's covering enough that you can, if you lower yourself, you're not as observed, etc. This is yudneen. Then it can recede. Now how far back can it recede? Then the hadith of the Prophet is used, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in which the Prophet marked the face in this way. So that's the limits of it, is how far back it can go, etc. Right? Then among our fuqaha, there's a debate on whether or not this includes niqab or not. You guys familiar with the term niqab? The entire veil. So they say that the thing should fall so low, the jilbab, that like that extra piece of cloth hanging above, in addition to the overgarment, that you don't even see the face of the woman, she can just see kind of at an angle in front of her. Right? And then that evolved into the niqab. Well, this angle thing is getting hard, let's just, we'll put one of those things on and work with that. Then some ulama considered it mandatory to wear the niqab, some said it's mustahab, some said it's not even from the sunnah, etc., etc. There's a big debate in our history. I was actually interested in the subject for myself, personally, and before I say what I'm going to say, I just want to let you know that my word on this stuff means absolutely nothing. Absolutely nothing. Why? Because this is a discussion you should have, if you're curious, with a what? Fiqh. With someone who studies fiqh, someone who studies Sharia and understands the aqwal of these scholars, etc. I was interested because my wife, before I married her, 6 months before I married her, started wearing niqab. And we were engaged at the time and she just started wearing niqab. I was like, well, where did that come from? What was that? So I wanted to research the subject for myself. And she was researching it herself too. She was contemplating it for some time. And whatever research, you know, I did and she did at the time, this is research that's what, 13 years ago? 14 years ago, so it's pretty old research. It's not new stuff. That and to whatever resources I had access to, we were convinced that the niqab is in fact part of our religion. It's not something that's just cultural. That it is found in the Salaf and it's found, you know, even among the Ummahatul Mu'mineen. But it, at least for our family, we consider it mustahab. It's not something that I say is mandatory on my wife. That we consider it something optional and preferred if she wants to. But she's not sinful if she doesn't do it. So it's entirely her choice. So that's at least the conclusion we reached. And then nowadays it's become this huge controversy and some people are like completely, it's fault. And I respect that opinion. That opinion exists and I respect it. Because these are not like just some random person just saying it's mandatory because I don't like women type thing. These are like female scholars too on that position. And then you have scholars that say that it's entirely cultural and it's not necessarily what you can conclude from the ayah. There's room to say that. There's room to say, but if you take all the tradition into consideration, at least from our limited analysis, it's part of the religion, but it's not at the crux of the religion. Meaning it's not something that, it's a make or break, you didn't meet the condition of the ayah. يُدْنِينَ مِنْ جَلَابِ بِهِنَّ. So what does it amount to then? You know, a modern day rendition of the jilbab could be like a loose overcoat. It could be a longer dress. And then fuqaha disagreed about how high it should be, and you know, like for Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, can it be two pieces? It's okay, is it to have an equivalent of two pieces? And it manifested in different ways. For example, in India, the shalwar kameez is basically a Muslim thing. And the way it manifests, there was shalwar, there was kameez, and in Urdu they say chadar, right? So the women traditionally wore the shalwar kameez, which was clothing, then a layer, and then the sheet wasn't small. You could feed 20 people in that chadar. Right? And that they would have that over, and that was their jilbab. And that serves as jilbab, because it is the outer garment. And that's the thing, you already have clothes on, and then on top of that there's a layer, that's called jilbab. It's the outer layer, it's the over layer, on top of your actual clothing. So يُدْنِينَ عَلَيْهِنَّ مِنْ جَلَابِيبِهِنَّ ذَلِكَ أَدْنَى أَنْ يُعْرَفْنَا. That is closer or that is more that's better. Closer here means better. And yu'rafna, that they be known, that they be recognized, meaning they be recognized as Muslims. فَلَا يُؤْذَيْنَا, so they wouldn't be caused harm, because when you realize they're Muslim, you're not going to mess with them. You're going to understand these are women that observe the laws of Islam, and they which are rooted in modesty and shame, and they don't interact with men for no without a purpose, etc. So they're going to be left alone. ذَلِكَ أَدْنَا أَيْ يُعْرَفْنَا. This part of the ayah is very important. What's the point, my young sister, if you're wearing jilbab, you're wearing hijab, and you're still like hanging out with guys at the MSA? ذَلِكَ أَدْنَا أَيْ يُعْرَفْنَا فَلَا يُؤْذَيْنَا. And you're just going out for some pizza, just hanging out. Where did you get this from? We're not supposed to have just casual hangouts with the opposite gender. I'm not passing a verdict that it's haram, but it's definitely questionable. Look at all the barriers in the surah. Look at all the protections that are placed. You know? And then at the end of it all, it's not in the Quran that we can't go out pizza, right? I couldn't find a hadith about for the prohibition of pizza with my MSA, therefore, it's all good. Look at the spirit of the text. Look at what the text is saying. You know, those innocent meetings you have aren't innocent. They're not. There's people sitting in that meeting that are, their mind's running crazy. Man, if I married her, that would be pretty good. We could do more MSA work. You know? And the other one's thinking about the other one, and this stuff happens. And people don't say it. So Allah says in the surah what? He knows what you show and He knows what you hide. You have to take those protective cautions. And girls especially, because I have girls, I'm one day they're going to be listening to this, maybe 5-6 years from now when they're teens, so I'm yelling at them ahead of time. I'm yelling at my own daughter. I'm not even talking to y'all. I'm talking to my own daughters. In the future. Because right now they're banned from this lecture. But in the future. Don't be dumb. Don't think boys aren't interested in you. Or you're just talking. There's no such thing. Be smart. Be aware. Be cautious. You're so oblivious. The boys, their hormones are always active. They're always thinking. It never turns off. They don't know how to turn it off. They don't know. Especially when they're younger. 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19. Now when does it turn off? About 30 minutes after death. That's when it turns off for men. Okay? It just, once it's on, it's on. Don't think that it's harmless conversation, or we're just discussing homework, or we're just... No, keep your voice stern. Avoid laughter, unnecessary laughter. Avoid small talk. You know? Ala qadri al-imkan, as much as possible. Nobody should get the wrong idea. You know? You may not even mean it. You may not even mean to send the wrong signal, but you will just because you said salam a certain way. Just because you said salam a certain way. Some of our fuqaha even went as far as to say, you don't even have to respond to a guy's salam if you don't know him. He says, "Assalamu alaikum, sister." Nice convention, isn't it? You walk away. You can say salam in your heart. It's okay. He'll live. Astaghfirullah al-azim. Allah says you should respond to the salam. It's okay. My dad can respond to your salam. You know, my brother over there, yep, he benches 360 pounds. He can respond to your salam. You know? So, you have to have a certain... And I'm not saying you don't respond to salam, but if you want to respond, then be like... Sound like you're mad at the world. Wa alaikum salam. He's finished. He's gone. I've mentioned that to you before, when يَغْضُضْنَا مِنْ أَصْوَاتِهِنَّ. Take a tough voice. And if you take a tough voice, you're safe. فَذَلِكَ أَدْنَى أَنْ يُعْرَفْنَا فَلَا يُؤْذَيْنَا وَكَانَ اللَّهُ غَفُورًا رَحِيمًا. And Allah has always been extremely merciful.